Hi everyone, welcome back to my channel. My name is Brittany Simon. In today's video, my friend Evie Lupine is joining us to have a conversation on asexuality, and I am really stoked to have it with her today. As many of you guys know, I am not asexual or on the gray spectrum scale. Is that how I say it? Gray sexual? Isn't gray like the umbrella term, Evie? What is it?
Oh, we get into a whole conversation about that. Do you want me to answer that now, or do you want to finish the intro?
Let's finish the intro. So okay, basically, okay. I know little to nothing, and since Evie is asexual, right, that's the identifying word you use, I figured why not ask Evie how to flirt asexual, date asexual, because many of you guys have been asking me, and gosh, you know, I just don't know how to answer that question. So thank you for being here.
Yeah, totally. Thanks for having me on. I love having these conversations. It's still Pride Month. It's June. And I love that asexual representation. So I guess the first question is like, what's the umbrella term? And depending on who you ask, it's a little bit different for everyone. But generally, like, ace spectrum or ace spec or asexuality is like the largest umbrella label. And then there are other things that fall underneath that. So there is like gray A or gray asexuality or demisexuality. There are some people that consider those two things, like gray A and demi, to be like separate, because there is this like idea of a spectrum between being asexual and non-asexual or allosexual. And some people see like asexual as covering everything until allosexual, and some people consider the space in between to be gray A and like have its own label. And it just depends on what resonates with you and what makes sense in your brain.
What's this allo? What's that word mean?
Allosexual just means that you're not asexual. You are somebody that experiences sexual attraction.
Okay,
so
sorry.
It's kind of like saying cis. Yeah, it's like it's very similar to that.
Interesting. Yeah. New things every day. Okay, keep going.
Yeah. So, you know, it really just depends on what works for you. And I would say that in my experience interacting with other ace people, like, we really don't care that much. We're not like, you're using this label the wrong way. I mean, if you go to certain parts of the internet, there's totally people like that. But otherwise, we're like a pretty happy bunch just to have other people around us that are also ace. And that's mostly what we're excited about.
Well, I love it because I do have like family members that are like identified as demisexual. And so it's always interesting because I understand like each label I can understand individually. I think it's always hard when you have umbrella terms to reference so many individual humans. But I also think it's really helpful. So one of the concerns a lot of people in my audience had who were identifying with these words is that they didn't know how to approach people. And so then I started to think like, okay, how do I flirt with people? And I'm going to be honest, it's very body focused. It's very up and down. It's very like things we could do together energy. So I'm wondering, how is it for you in like your everyday life, right? Like, you've been like this for as long as I've known you, I assume your whole life, right? Is it something, is asexual a sexual orientation?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Most people would consider it to be. And I would say that one of the best things you can do if you have trouble just like approaching people is to cut out the middleman and use like dating apps. Like, you don't have to rely on that physicality and that sort of like flirtatious presence when you're on a dating app. Like, you know, I would stay away from the Tinder-esque platforms that are usually more sexually focused, but things like Bumble or OkCupid tend to be more, at least originally, more like long-term dating focused. And so it's easier to be an ace people on those websites. And I know for a fact that OkCupid has like asexual and demisexual as options that you can put in when you make your profile. So you can just have it right on there. I'm asexual, advertise what that is up front. And so when you are messaging people, you're going off of like those match percentages, their photos, like what they say their hobbies are, and you don't have to do that like flirty stuff if that's intimidating for you. And I think that can be advantageous. The problem is that even with that, a lot of people don't know what like being ace means or how to have a relationship with that, unless you're like happening to find other people that are also ace or demi or what have you. So if you are interacting with people like in person, directly in real life, I think there's sort of two parts to this, which is like, how do you like recognize and react to when people are flirting with you? And how do you like start flirting with other people? I think this also can be broken down also into like, are you like socialized as male or socialized as female? And like the types of people you're trying to attract and flirt with. There's like, you know, a million different variations on this. My technique is honestly like not even really flirting with people. Like, I don't do what I think most people would consider to be like traditional like flirting. I just like try to evaluate them as like somebody I want to be friends with, and like approach that person as somebody I want to be friends with. Because for me, regardless of if the relationship is sexual or romantic or anything else, I want to have that foundation of friendship first. And so because that's so important, I try to establish that first. So it's flirting, but like for friendship, oh more gosh. So than like for romantic stuff. So it's like, what kind of, like, you know, figure out what kind of hobbies they're into, what their interests are, you know, what their fashion sense is. Giving general compliments, I think, is really key. There's a video I watched recently that was talking about, actually, I can't remember exactly what the title was, but it was talking about like male like dating advice and like how flawed male dating advice is. And the guy that made the video had like fallen down the rabbit hole of the very MRA like pickup culture stuff, or pickup artist stuff rather, and he kind of looked at that and then took the pieces of advice he got from that were actually like helpful and useful. And one of the things that he talked about was like to have something that's just like a quick compliment, like, oh hey, I don't have very long, but I just wanted to say like your hair looks really nice today, or I love that necklace, or I love the band that's like on your t-shirt or whatever, like just something that's really quick and not also like too aggressive, but does open that window to have a conversation if the person's available for that.
Yeah,
and I think that works really great if you're in kind of like nerdy spaces, geek spaces, kink spaces. Like people usually have something that like you can relate to and identify with, and that makes it a little bit easier.
Okay, I gotta ask though, because right away in my head, I agree with you. I always tell people this too, that I do like the idea of being friends with the person that I'm attracted to, because I mean, I respect my friends and I'd like the idea of dating someone that I could be friends with. But then right away in my head is like friend zone, friend zone, friend zone. So how, so does this like, you know, we've been, I'm going to be honest, like I've been in such kink safe, sex positive circles for so long that I forget that I haven't dated anyone in a couple years now, and I'm honestly really nervous to start kind of like talking to people who don't necessarily have our background. But that's maybe why I don't date people, because how would you explain, like, I'm not friend zoning you, I'm literally, well maybe I am a little bit, but not in the bad way, because I just want to know if you're a good friend before I date you.
Oh yeah, I think definitely I could see how that would be like, definitely some people would take it as like, hey, why aren't we moving in this direction like fast enough, and that like must mean you don't really like me. And I think honestly it isn't even really necessarily an asexual thing. Like some people want to take their relationships slowly, they want to make sure they have that core compatibility first before they, you know, truly invest in the relationship romantically or sexually. So I think if it was me and I was trying to explain something to someone, I would just say, hey, like I'm not trying to friend zone you, I just want to make sure we have that like compatibility first, and we have that relationship that we can rely on before like getting into something deeper. And I think that will kind of naturally sort out the people that are going to be okay with like the speed of an asexual relationship versus looking for something that's maybe a little bit more like sex by the second date, let's say.
Yeah. Okay, question, because on my channel we've been exploring like this concept of energy a little outside of religious setting, but just this idea that in BDSM we exchange energy, we have power exchange, we bring energy into a relationship, and a lot of my flirting energy is like I push it onto the person I'm attracted to see if they like it. Like it's not even words, sometimes it's just like the body language or space. Do asexuals have an energy type themselves, like in which they can, you know, like how does that make sense?
They can like communicate with each other, like yeah, sonar. Like, you know, it's funny because I do know, like, especially in kink spaces, I know a lot of particularly like asexual men, and what I've experienced being in like kink spaces where there's also asexual people around and we're just only with each other, it's like kind of, I would describe it as like a wall of friend zoning, because like I don't think any of us are actually involved with any of the other ones outside of like a casual like friendly play scenario, maybe. We're all just like happy to be around each other and be like, hey fellow asexual, isn't life weird sometimes, look at this like funny experience that we've all shared, like it's we tend to like find each other because there is that like comfortableness in that, like it's almost like you're projecting out energy and it's not going anywhere, and then they project energy at you and it's not going anywhere, and it's just like comfortable silence.
I like that though. Okay, I just I just had a conversation with someone about this, about how, you know, we I don't think it's wrong for us to end up dating people that are similar to us. Like, I a lot of my trans friends like to date trans people because they feel like they understand them. I told someone the other day, I need a man. If I date a man, I know women are going to have it, because, like, to date a woman, you would have to be gay, like me. But, like, when if I marry a man, I want him to have, like, gay energy. And everyone's like, what do you mean? I was like, I don't mean, like, gay man. I mean, I want him to have queer energy, to, because I'm too queer. Like, I can't – I don't think I could do straight man energy. Like, I'm going to be real. Like, I don't think I could, realistically. I just – I don't know how that would melt in our world. Like, what am I going to do? I don't know. It's just different energy. I'm not judging. But it's, like, different energy. Yeah. You know? So I guess – would you say that as asexual people – like, you haven't primarily dated just asexual people, though, right?
No, I did. I actually, how I was introduced to asexuality is I dated someone in high school that was asexual, and that was the first time I had ever heard the term. But, like, realistically, like, our big organizations like AVEN, which is, like, the Asexuality Visibility and Education Network, is the term's been around for a long time, but it's only really been known as, like, a label in the way that, like, lesbian or even bisexual has been in, like, maybe 15 years, like, really well-known in, like, 10 years. So, like, there just hasn't even really been a lot of time to, like, openly find and date other asexuals, because it just wasn't an option or, like, a word that matched with an experience.
Yeah.
I do understand what you're saying, though, about wanting, like, your experience as, like, a queer woman and having that, like, reflected in your partners. Like, because otherwise it's, like, they maybe, like, don't get you to, like, the same degree, right? Yeah. It's, like, you know, you're, like, just too heterosexual for me, basically.
There are men who are, and women who are straight, who can understand queerness a little bit, but there's, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, you walk into your room, you're like, this smells very straight in here. It just feels, you know what I mean? And it's not a judgment. It's not a judgment. It's literally just an awareness that, like, oh, it's kind of a gay judgment. Like, a little, like, there's just a crossover. You know what I mean? There's just a part of queerness in which, like, when Marcus and I and my brother hang out, like, he's like, I'm more gay when I'm around you. I was like, it's because when you're around a queer, you get more queer.
This goes.
We build off each other. But, like, when I'm around the heteros, I, like, quiet it down because they want different energy, which is so fine. I love that I can go between groups. So I wondered if it was, like, similar, too.
Yeah, it's almost like code switching for sexuality. Like, in this space, I'm going to be more gay. In this space, I'm going to be more ace. In this space, I'm going to be more het, because that's, like, the energy of other people. And, like, I know that I have friends, especially, where, like, just, it's not, like, a sexuality thing. It's just being in the room with that friend, you, like, match that friend's energy.
Yes.
And then you just, you know, you go on that level together of wherever you're at. So I think there's that for asexuals as well, where when we hang out together, it's just, like, oh, thank God. We're not, like, constantly, like, wondering if we're misreading, like, people's body language, or, like, something was flirtatious or in innuendo when we didn't realize it. I would say, though, at least in my experience, that a lot of asexuals have, like, a gift for, like, innuendo, almost because, like, we don't, like, realize it's happening, and so it just ends up, like, being funnier as a result.
Oh, my god.
There was a board game that I remember I played in high school with some of my friends, and I don't know what it was called. It was almost like Cards Against Humanity, like that kind of idea of a game. But the cards were basically all, like, innuendos. But you had to, like, figure out what the card was actually trying to say outside of, like, the innuendo. And I cannot remember any examples of this, but I remember being really good at that game because, like, the innuendo, like, part of it did not trip me up at all.
Oh, I'm just like, so great.
That means that. That's what it is. And it's, you know, I wish I could remember what that game was in more detail, but it's been, like, 10 years since I played it.
Can you also explain to people, because I'm curious too, so obviously when I was being raised, like, if you're talking about sexual orientation, it was who you were attracted to, not how you were attracted to. I'm wondering, how do you define, like, that part of your sexual orientation of who you're attracted to versus how you're attracted to?
Yeah, so I think definitely there's, like, multiple ways to interpret this. In the asexuality community, we actually came up with this model called the SAM model, which is the split attraction model. Because there's this idea that, like, you might not be sexually attracted to somebody, but you might be romantically attracted to them. And I know this is...
Ace people made that up?
Yeah, Ace people made that up.
Oh my gosh, that's so funny.
I'm sure.
I had to fact check myself. Okay, so cool. Okay, keep going. That's so interesting.
Yeah, so we made that idea up because, like, the idea of being on the ace spectrum is that, like, you don't experience sexual attraction with, like, a small, like, end note that, like, well, Demi's experience under this condition and blah, blah, blah. You know, there's a little bit more nuance there. But for asexual people, like the idea is you don't experience sexual attraction. It's like being a zero, right? You know, if like being heterosexual is a one and being gay is a 10, like being asexual is a zero. But at the same time, like you can still experience romantic attraction and want to date people and make a life with them and have kids with them and have all that stuff happen without having the sexual component.
Absolutely.
And that is usually, and that's usually what motivates, you know, again, in my experience, tends to be what motivates asexual people more in relationships, is having that romantic connection and wanting to have a life partner, a partner in crime, all of that stuff. But, you know, to some extent, you know, there's also some ace people are more okay with sex than others. Some of them, like, I talked to somebody last night that was like, I don't want any sex at all. I don't want genitals involved at all. Like, at any point, I just don't ever want that. And then there's people like me where, like, I consider sex to be, you know, an important, like, socially understood, like, bonding experience for a relationship. And so understanding how it sort of enhances and like reinforces the romantic component of the relationship, I'm like more comfortable engaging in sexual activities because it's part of like what goes towards the half of the relationship that I enjoy and that motivates me.
That makes total sense. That makes sense. Give me 2.5 seconds to grab a tissue though, girl. My allergies are trying to murder me.
I feel ya.
You know Zizek, right? The philosopher?
Yes. Yeah.
So you know how he's always like touching his face?
Yes.
I always joke with my
classic sniff.
I joke with my audience. I'm like, bro, I'm going to become the next Zizek with the way that my allergies try to kill me every show. Okay, now I'm curious because I'm going to be real with you. Can I just tell you, I have judged for so many years so hard this idea of like separating sexual and romantic attraction because I only put it in the lens of queerness. So I only put it in the lens of gayness. But now I'm like, oh my God, that makes so much more sense that asexuals might be trying to communicate their feelings. And that makes so much more sense to me than like, because I had a hard time as like trusting that women were attracted to me because they were like, I'm not sexually attracted to you. And I'm like, what does that mean? And then I realized like maybe they were trying to say, because they kept saying I'm romantically attracted to you. And I was like, that's great. But for me, sexual orientation is like sexual orientation. So I think of sexuality and I combine it with physical affection. So my brain just did like one of those things where I went, and now I'm like, this makes so much sense because for me, you know me, I like more choices, more words to describe what we're going through and what's going on in life.
Yeah.
So this is so much more helpful. I hope my audience just feels as relieved as I do hearing this because
it can. I think it helps explain a lot of experiences because I was kind of thinking about that as well. Like when we were talking about this as sort of the application for like wider queer understanding of relationships, is I know a lot of people struggle with understanding this, but I think thinking about it, like somebody might be like heterosexual or like bisexual and like heteroromantic or biromantic and heterosexual. You have like interesting combinations of sexuality and like romantic attraction. I would also say I think part of it specifically when it comes to like lesbian or gay relationships is that like we are just taught like so heavily that heterosexual sex is like the way to have sex, and there's so little like widely distributed, you know, representation of gay and lesbian like sexual relationships and what that even means or looks like, that it can be very hard unless you're like one of the top tier gays, let's say, where you're like very, very strongly oriented that way to understand how that feels. And I don't know if you heard of like Elena Joy at all. Have you like seen her?
I feel
channel?
Like I know this name, but I can't imagine their face. Let me Google while you talk about
it. Yeah, so I really recommend watching some of her videos because she has a very interesting experience where she had a very long-term life partner that was a man. She was also attracted to women, and she identified as bisexual because of that. But over the years of being in a relationship with that person, with that man, she slowly realized that she was actually just gay.
And yeah, I know this girl.
Man was like the only person that she was attracted to, and she realized that like she had like basically convinced herself that like something was there that wasn't really there because it felt like that was what was normal and that was like what was acceptable.
For sure.
I thought that was like a really interesting like transformation, like understanding of yourself and your sexuality, and like sometimes we just don't know how we feel.
You know, it's funny. I've met a few girls, women who've experienced them. I heard a story about a girl. She was friends with my friend who was dating a girl. And at the time I was like 15 and in the closet. And so they were like, you should talk to this girl. She's dating a girl. But then when I talked to her, she was like, oh, I'm only dating this girl. And I was like, what do you mean? She goes, I know I'm into men, but this girl is the only exception to that rule. And I was like, and I wonder if that's happening for a lot of girls who are dating guys, or if we date so young, we fall in love and then we figure we'll build a life with this person, but then realize parts of our, because I know for myself, like I'm not a learner who learned all my lessons early. Like I'm an old learner. I burned my hand up until 30, like on the stove. Like I still touch the stove sometimes just to check. Like I'm definitely one of those learners. Now I am curious though. Because, how do I say this? So asexuality, because it is a spectrum, and you're dating all these individual people, have you ever run into problems being asexual in a way that's significant or in a way that's pretty on par with, like, being gay in general, being other in general? Or do you think there's more of a stigma or a harder time dating?
I wouldn't say there's a stigma against, like, the label or the word in particular. I would say what ends up happening, and that has happened multiple times over the course of my life, is at the beginning of the relationship, people are like, great, I understand this, that makes sense, and they're, like, accepting of it, and they get it, and then, like, 2 years into the relationship, or, like, a year or 6 months or whatever, usually it ends up being in, like, the 6 month to year kind of threshold. They're like, actually, like, I'm not really okay with this, and it, like, makes, because it ends up, they take somebody's lack of sexual attraction as, like, an insult towards them.
For sure.
As being, like, well, you're not attracted to me because you think I'm ugly, or because you think I'm disgusting, or because of whatever, and it's like, well, it's not, like, anything about you, this is just how my brain works, and so because they don't feel comfortable being in a relationship where the sexual attraction isn't such an important component, they just don't want to be in the relationship anymore. I would say I've had, I think, 3 relationships end because of some variety of, like, people being okay with asexuality up front and then, like, realizing later on into it they're not really that comfortable with it.
Yeah.
What tends to happen a lot, I think, is if you are somebody that is asexual and sex repulsive, this is going to be different. But for me, because I am okay with, like, a degree of sexual interaction, people, like, conveniently forget about the asexuality and they're, like, surprised by it. When they're like, oh, well, you were okay with this last week. And I'm like, yeah, I was okay with doing it, like, once a week. That was, like, my threshold of what I'm okay with. And, again, it ends up being this problem of, like, it's almost like they try to convince you you're not asexual and then, like, take it as an insult when you, like, reinforce that that's, like, what you're comfortable with and not. And I think that's the most widely experienced difficulty that I know a lot of asexual people have in their relationships is people, like, they don't mean to. I don't think this is generally malicious, but, like, being, like, pressured and, like, coerced into doing sexual stuff they're not okay with because then their partners are unhappy. Even scenarios, even in open relationship scenarios, it still happens. For sure. It doesn't make it a little bit better, but it doesn't necessarily completely get rid of it.
Okay, gosh. Okay, I have, like, 2 directions I want to go in, but I'll do this to remember. So I'm going to ask a question. Obviously, don't answer anything you're uncomfortable with.
Okay.
Okay, weirdly enough, so obviously we're in BDSM, so, like, physical rewards, like patting on the head or, like, some sort of physical contact is always reassuring and good. Whether, like, I don't practice. What do I say? I like BDSM in my sex, but I like no sex in my BDSM. know? So, like, I don't practice sexual BDSM. Like, I don't try to, it's not my, like, vibe. The energy is different for me. But physical rewards are always nice. And I realize, like, even in BDSM, I like kisses, I like head pets, I like all those things. Is kissing considered a sexual thing in your brain, or is it more like just an affectionate pat on the head equal to?
I would consider it either, like, an affectionate, like, sensual kind of thing, where, like, the sensation of it is nice and it's, like, reassuring, or a romantic thing. I don't really consider it to be a sexual thing. Actually, I have very specific, like, limits over, like, what kind of kissing I like and don't like. Like, if you're going to put your tongue in my mouth, don't do that. If you're, like, if your saliva tastes a certain way, don't do that. Like, it works, but only in very particular scenarios. And I think a lot of people are that way. Like, when you think about it, smushing your lips together, like, the place where the food goes in is, like, kind of a weird, like, concept. It's, like, a sexual thing, but that's
humans are such animals.
It's going to be.
We're such animals. Like, even the way we make love is so, like, it's so funny and animalistic to me, but I love it because we're just such, like, little creatures. But I think that's a funny little thought process. Are you done with that thought? I don't want to interrupt it.
Yeah, I'm done with that thought.
So, funny enough, recently, a homie of mine, you know, we had our call, and I've known her for literally, like, forever and a day, since I was, like, maybe 18 or 19. And we were chatting. She goes, I have to come out to you. And I was like, you're coming out to me? How? Like, what? And I used to have a whole thing for her way back in the day, and you know, she's not queer, so like, I'm like, you know, she's not into girls. But so she comes to me and she says, I'm asexual. And I was like, and I was like, oh my gosh, okay, yeah, okay, great. And then she was like, it's mm-hmm. because of you I realized I was asexual. I was like, oh, now I'm confused. And I go,
whoa, okay,
hold on. And I go, what's this about? So she says to me, she goes, I have seen you almost destroy your life over and over again for sex. I was like, facts. Mm-hmm. And so she goes, I just couldn't understand all these years why you were willing to like go into toxic places or mess with toxic people just to get laid. I was like, sex is so good. And then she was like, Brittany, I've never done this. And I was like, oh yeah. And all these years we were wondering why she's still single. She wants a partner. She wants babies. Mm. But every time she has sex with guys, she's just like, okay, that was like whatever. And then she realized, oh my God, I've been dating all wrong this whole time. And so now in her 30s, she's like redoing her dating pool. And hopefully it's more successful, but it makes so much sense that, thank God I was like a comparison for her, because I told her, I was like, thank God I've been reckless with my life so you can have this moment.
It's been good for something. Yeah, yeah.
No, exactly. I know we're all struggling and we're all finding out different things about ourselves, and we're living in a very freaking beautiful modern time. Somebody asked me, Brittany, would you have wanted to be born in a different time since you're more traditional? And I was like, I am on OnlyFans. I am queer on the internet. I am naked everywhere. At what point in history would I have survived?
Like, yeah, yeah.
At what point? No, this is the time to be alive. I have a job full time on the internet. On the internet. This is the time for Brittany to have been alive. And same with my friend. And same for a lot of us who I think are other. Like, we're experiencing a realization of, oh, this could be our time. Mm-hmm. Like, our real time. Do you feel like asexuality is something that – is it weird in my head? It just seems very normal in my head.
Wait, so you're asking if it seems weird that it's normal?
No, yeah, like, did you think, like, it should be weird, or do you think people, because I know people at first were, like, apprehensive about it, but now it's so normal in my head, I can't remember if regular society still thinks it's abnormal.
I think it really depends on, like, what age bracket you're looking at. I think the Zoomers and, like, the younger millennials, I feel like we've got it figured out. We're like, oh, okay. Like, it surprised me the same way that poly surprised me. When I found out about it, or I was like, I didn't realize that was an option. I just didn't think that, like, you could opt out, or in the case of poly, you could opt into having multiple relationships. Yes. I was like, oh, that's just, like, because my brain, and I don't know if this is the way it was when you were in high school, but, like, for me, it was, like, you got to choose between, like, gay, lesbian, heterosexual, and, like, maybe bisexual if you were being a little spicy. Like, that was about what you got, and I was like, oh, you can just, like, not be one of those, or, like, have a variation on that? I had no idea. And I think the larger, like, society is still very in the place of, like, oh, well, like, being asexual means you haven't found the right person yet. You haven't had good sex yet. That's something, the biggest comment I get is, like, people think it's a hormonal issue. That, like, if you're asexual, it's, like, because you have a psychological disorder, because you, like, have something going on funky with your hormones. Not that my intense medical records are anybody's business, but my hormones are fine. I did a whole, like, mail out blood kit. They tested everything. It's all normal. And I, you know, there are going to be people, and I know a lot of, like, you know, trans people that go on hormone replacement therapy talk about how that hormone replacement therapy process, like, kills their sex drive.
Yeah,
so there can be an element of it that is, you know, that it can be, maybe a low sex drive can be connected to the, you know, changing of hormones, or they're not being kind of in their normal levels. But that's not, I don't think, representative of the average asexual experience. And I think most people do consider it to some degree to be abnormal, depending in what spaces you're operating in. I think online and, like, kind of the younger people, it's like, oh, okay, cool. Whether or not it's, like, valid as, like, a sexual orientation and, like, belongs at Pride or things like that is, like, completely different conversation. Because there are a lot of people, especially, like, you remember Tumblr? Remember the Tumblr gatekeeping days of, like, who could be a real gay or not? Or, like, what colors belonged in the pride flag or whatever? Like, which pride flags were allowed or not? Like, there was definitely a specifically anti-asexual Tumblr community.
Really?
That was, like, an actual thing. I don't think it really ever got very big. I've tried to look at it again recently, but, like, Tumblr's just been completely nuked, so it's hard to find stuff these days. But there was they had their hashtags, they had their own groups and flags and whatever else, and Tumblr blogs, and they just were, like, I don't even know why they had a problem with it. They were just, like, asexuality is not a real sexual orientation. Get off this website. Like, they were very mad about it for some reason. And I hope they found peace, because that seems like a very, like, disruptive thing to be mad about.
Am I crazy? Wouldn't it make sense that in the evolutionary process that some humans would come out with different variations of sex drive?
Yeah, you think that that would be, like, it's like, oh, yeah, that makes sense. Like sure. I feel, but yeah, people, yeah. Whenever there's a new thing, someone's going to get mad about it.
That
people
is true.
People get mad about bisexuals. People get mad about pansexuals. It's part that of the is process, true. I think.
But that's the crazy thing is, like, in my head, I'm thinking, okay, if we have variation of human and humans are wildly independent and interesting, and though categorized, y'all know I love to categorize humans. But at the same time, for me, sex drive makes sense that it would be on a spectrum because it also holds a function. It was funny because some people were investigating whether or not the gay gene existed as actually an evolutionary process to create caregivers within tribes who weren't going to fuck with the romantic entanglement of the, like, core anchor part, like the anchor
oh,
couple.
Oh yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that's interesting to me too. Overall, I know that people are always asking me to, like, can you check out if being gay is, like, an anomaly? And I'm like, I'm not a scientist. I'm a YouTuber. But overall, regardless of the answers, I think that the reality is that humans have these desires, they operate these ways, our brains are uniquely this mm-hmm. way. And regardless of whether or not it is an anomaly, because for me, anomaly doesn't necessarily mean negative. It could just mean rare to some extent. It is yeah. something that's being expressed. The newer generations, though, Evie, I'm going to be real. First of all, I'm totally out of it. I just got a TikTok. I feel old as fuck. But I just got one, and I'm watching all these kids, and I'm trying to watch all the queer TikToks. And they're very focused on, like, labels, on identifiers, which is, like, fine, a little too much for me. But at the same time, I wonder, where does asexuality play into this role of, like, labeling, and how important is it when expressing who you are as a person?
Yeah, I think that asexuality is, like I kind of talked about earlier, like, as a term, I mean, it's, you know, you can find, like, literary references to it and other, like, small references to it going back for a long time, but in terms of, like, having a wider community understanding and having a place where we could, like, share our experiences, it's really been since the start of the internet. It hasn't really been that long. We don't even, like the oldest people that are, like, active members of the asexuality community are in their, like, 40s and 50s, like, that have been there since they were in their, like, 20s and 30s. So you think about it, we don't even have, like, you know, like, you don't have really, like, previous gay generations, like, in terms of asexuality. We don't have that to be like, how is it in your day? How did you find your labels? And so, like, it's really in its infancy in terms of, like, kind of solidifying labels and definitions and categories and all that stuff. I think whenever it comes to young people trying to figure out who they are, like, labels are always going to be a thing, right? Whether that be, like, are you a goth? Are you a punk? Are you, like, a skater kid? Like, trying to figure out whatever the modern age is deciding to categorize people by is, like, yeah. the most important thing. Like, kids are going to gravitate towards that and try to figure out, who am I? Where do I belong? What label fits for me? And I think as those kids get older, it'll probably start to, like, wear off. And they'll be like, yeah, I am what I am. And this is what I thought I was when I was 16. And I didn't know what I didn't know yet. And I yeah. just am how I am today, and that's fine. But I wonder how long it is going to carry over, because I think it's going to be a little bit more of something that carries on for longer, I think, just because of the nature of the internet today than yeah. maybe it would have, like, when I was in high school.
Now, do you think there's a correlation between lesbian bed death and heterosexual couples stopping to have sex after 3 years, and maybe people not realizing, like, maybe they're ace to some extent? Because I always thought this was interesting, because in my head I'm like, how could you stop having sex? Like, I don't understand that. But now I'm wondering if they're together for 30 years and they only have sex maybe once every 6 months, like, is that some variation of it? Like, do you think? Or is that a reach?
I mean, I think you can be heterosexual and have a low sex drive. And then you can be asexual. I think it may be a process where, like, some people, like, that are less, like, sex, like, people that are more, like, how do I phrase it? Let me think. Like, people that are more, like, sex neutral or sex favorable aces, which are, like, asexual people that are more okay with sex acts, they would probably get to a point in the relationship where, like, okay, great, we're married. I don't have to keep performing this thing that I'm not really into anymore. And it's kind of like just being able to, like, let go and relax and not feel like that pressure as much maybe anymore because the relationship's more mature.
Mm-hmm.
That could be a component of some people being asexual. I think, like, in the reality of the world, it probably has more to do with the fact that, like, it is very easy to get complacent in a relationship and to not focus on that spark and to get distracted by work, other life things,
yeah.
Kids being in the rat race, you know, taking care of elderly family members, you know, infinite numbers of other things that maybe take priority and detract from, like, your own sexual libido. True. If you're gay or bi or heterosexual, whatever else. It's like, you know, when you have 10,000 things going on in your to-do list, like, a lot of people, just the sheer stress from all that is going to make them so they don't even think about sex.
For sure.
And some people are like, sex is how I get my release from all that stuff, and I need to make sure it's an important part of it. And then you go to sex therapy, you go to couples therapy, and you work that shit out.
Amen, amen.
That's what you do.
That's interesting. So, okay, my brain is processing, because I'm processing, because I know, like, asexual people can also be queer or straight or all these things. Do you run into, like, do you run into issues with that at all, or not really? I assume not.
I, like, personally, no. I mean, most of the other ace people I know are, like, dominant heterosexual men. So I'm not really sure exactly of the queer experience of being asexual, how that might be different. I would say the most clear example I could run into is, like, being an asexual person that wants to date somebody of, like, the same gender, right? So if you're, like, an asexual woman that wants to date another woman, because people have that, like, oh no, I'm secretly dating a straight girl. They're not really into me. This is like a performance thing, like anxiety. There can be that issue where it's because of, you know, that experience, they interpret somebody's lack of sexual attraction towards them, even when they have very strong romantic attraction, as being like, you're secretly heterosexual and in 2 years you're gonna break up with me to be with a man.
Yeah.
Like that kind of thing, I think, is the most widely experienced issue.
Makes sense. Now, asexuality in my head has nothing to do with anything more than, like, whether or not sexual acts are something they desire. Is that the right way to say it?
I think about it like, do you want to engage in a sexual act, like, with a particular person? Like, do you experience the attraction to want to have sex with a particular person? Because I think that does a better job of delineating, like, libido and sex drive from orientation.
Yes.
Because, again, you can have a low sex drive and be hetero or whatever.
Go into that a little bit, because I just want to make sure my audience gets it, make sure I get it, because that's the separation my brain is, like, having a second with. So, because at first I thought it was asexuals have no libido.
Yeah. I think a lot of people, like, assume that, because I think most ace people are going to be on, like, the lower side of the libido scale, but it's about, do you want to have sex with a particular person? Like, when you see somebody at a bar, like, do you think, oh wow, their dress looks cute, or do you think, wow, they're hot, I want to take them home later? Like, what is your thought process when you see somebody and you have that initial spark of attraction? What does that look like? What is it motivated by? And you generally, again, most asexual people are probably on that lower end of the libido scale as well. But there are also asexual people that have a high libido and just masturbate a lot. And when they masturbate, they usually don't, like, consume pornography. Oh. It's a very, like, this is something I think is very common for, like, asexual men, because there is that, like, biological component of, like, needing to release, like, certain bodily fluids on a regular basis for your health. And so it tends to be, like, almost a kind of more, like, mechanical process, as opposed to, like, having a particular fantasy about somebody or with somebody. It's like, I have this biological need that needs to be fulfilled in the same way that, like, you need to blow your nose, basically.
Which I do. Thank you for reminding me. Listen, okay, this is a really good explanation, because now I'm imagining that, because I do put masturbation in two categories, sexual masturbation and itching, like, scratching an itch masturbation.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. So that makes sense.
Would it be, like, something like that where it's not even, like, sexual? It's just, like, a thing that your body does and it feels better and you feel like got it done to some extent.
Yeah. Got to order my groceries, got to take the dog on a walk, masturbate. Like, that's on the to-do list.
That makes so much sense, though. Okay, that is so much of a clearer concept in my head. I'm so glad we went into it a little bit more. Okay, now, and I wondered, since I have you here, and I know your content, so guys, please go check out Evie's channel for lots of videos on asexuality and lots of videos on BDSM, and check that out. But is there anything that in particular you know would, like, really help my audience, something that's been on your mind that we can explain to them in the flirtation game, in the dating game? COVID is, you know, we're getting better. Vaccines are out. People are socializing.
Oh, yeah. I think, we are having a lot of, like, discussion about, like, oh, my God, what do we do? Because, like, dating is happening again. So I would say I would go back to maybe one of the first points I made, which is like using dating apps and just being like as clear as possible up front. Like if you're ace, if you are demi, if you're whatever label mm-hmm. you use, being as like clear and upfront about that. Like if you are getting back into the dating game, like don't play around, don't play games, like ask for what you want and get what you want. Like, don't settle for people that aren't going to be compatible with you. Don't, like, spend 4 months texting somebody and spending all your energy on them and only focusing on them to find out that they're, like, not okay with you being ace or whatever. Mm. Don't do that. We've all learned, like, time is precious. It's of the essence. Don't waste it on people you're not going to end up having the kinds of relationships you want to have with.
Dude, did I tell you? I guess... Yeah, I did. I told you I was seeing YouTube comment guy. That's what I called him on my last podcast. And so we ended things, but one of the things I told him was like, I'm not going to get off my butt and come meet you unless we cover all the hardcore questions first. I don't need one reason to meet you. I need like 30 reasons to make sure that like we're compatible and one reason to know. Mm-mm. So like we talked about everything, you know, from religion to how to raise kids to what if we have this kid and that kid and all these other things. And so that's like the first thing we covered too was what's your sex drive like and what do you imagine? Because the average couple is, I think, having sex 1.5 times a month right now. I don't know if that's still accurate. Well, I don't know if it's still accurate. But
COVID babies for that number to be true, but okay.
Dude, I really thought people were going to have more sex during COVID. But people didn't like spending that much time together, I think.
They're like, no, you're gross now. Stay away from me.
Honestly. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, I just as like as a final note, I think that so there's two ways of going about it. I think you can either like do that like whole like racket of questions. You're like, okay, what do you think about kids, religion, where do you want to like grow old, like what state do you want to be in, like all of those questions are really great and getting them out before you meet somebody. I have been kind of trying the opposite technique where like I meet somebody on OkCupid, we have a really high match percentage, we're like 99-98%. And, you know, I read their profile, nothing's like a red flag, no Nazis, whatever. And I'm just like, okay, let's go on a date. I just get into that, like, in-person interaction so you can have that energy reading where you're like, okay, like, you're giving me that, like, energy that I want. And then having those, like, important conversations first. How do you feel about kids? Do you like pets? I went on a date with somebody, like, I don't know, earlier this week, and I found out they didn't like animals. And I'm like, I don't know. I don't think, like, we're going to have the kind of relationship that I want to have, because like I have a dog that's like my whole world, and like if you're just like lukewarm on dogs, like it's probably not gonna work.
Heck so, no. You know. Okay, wait, so I got a question for you, because like, and this is a more question for me though. I am like paranoid about meeting people.
Okay.
Just being me and like my job and like us, and I'm always like, just freaking like, out.
Is this gonna be a person that knows me from the internet? Like,
and like are stuff. They well, you know, because I believe like YouTubers can date their adult fans as long as they're not there's not a really gross parasocial relationship. Obviously that'd be toxic, but my concern is that, because I want people to like my work, like who date me, because I've dated people who didn't like my work, right? And I didn't like that. But at the same time, I'm afraid of physically going and meeting people, and that's just like, I think I have this paranoia because I've had a stalker that like they're gonna use this as a way into my life, which I want them to do because we're dating, but into my YouTube life instead of me life. How have you balanced that out?
Usually what ends up happening is, one, obviously, like, meet people in a public place, lots of people, you know, not pitch dark in an alleyway somewhere. Like, if you're worried about somebody being, like, suddenly really confrontational. But usually I try to have the conversation about, like, me being a YouTuber and being online, like, fairly quickly. Like, the last time I went out with somebody, I think we literally talked for, like, a minute before we, like, talked about what we did for work. And I'm like, oh, I'm on the internet, I have a YouTube channel. And then I try to read their reaction to that to try and gauge if they know me or not, and if they're like lying about if they know me or not. I haven't had any issues personally with somebody like knowing my channel. And then usually what ends up happening is if people like find me on dating websites, they either like flag my account for like catfishing because they don't think it's really me, or because they're like, oh, somebody's stealing your pictures, and I'm like, no, that's literally just me. Or people like message me ahead of time to say like, oh wow, I really like your channel. And so like usually the people that are really gung-ho about it, like, notice that ahead of time. And I'm like, hey, you know, thanks for the message. I'm not really interested in, like, you know, interacting with anybody that's a fan. But, like, I hope you have, you know, a good time on his website. Good luck. And then I just move on. So that's usually how I handle it. I haven't had any big issues. But, like, dating when you're, like, a like a D tier like internet celebrity is like really hard because you're not like good enough for like the YouTube specific dating apps or the celebrity dating apps. But like if you're in a local area, people know you live in, you know, San Jose or LA or whatever else, and like, you know, random people just see you on there, like it's really hard to like actually, I think, like, I also have to think about, you ever, if you've used dating apps, you like, I definitely am very careful with what I say in my dating apps, knowing that people that may know me from the internet like could find it.
Well, I just stopped using them, basically. I just did a podcast about my experiences, and my problem is that I don't even tell the internet where I live, like what state.
Oh, yeah.
So
yeah.
My fear is that like I'm on a dating app and then all of a sudden they're like, oh, Brittany's dating this area. Brittany lives here.
Yeah.
So I'm like, I'm the worst kind of person to date ever because I don't, I'm so private now.
You have to be like, I'm in Antarctica. Don't ask me where I'm at. That's what my fat life, I think, says. Of my cat. If you like my cat, you will talk and then tell me if you like kids or not.
No, exactly. Oh, cats and kids. Like, those are the two requirements at least to start off. Okay, let's get back to asexuality because that's why we're here, folks. This is what happens when Evie and I talk. We're like, wait a second, derail for a second. All right, guys. So Evie and I derailed for a second there, but we're actually going to wrap it up because I think we've answered everything that you guys had sent me about asexuality at the moment. Of course, we'll do follow-up videos if you guys so would desire. And please go check out Evie's channel, especially since she already has so many videos on asexuality. It's just... they're probably answered there, those questions. So check those
probably
out.
Probably. I have a lot.
Exactly. Do you have any final words for the audience? Anything you want to tell them? Anywhere to find you? Anywhere you want to give them your literal names? I'll link you, of course, girlfriend. Like, I'll link you.
Yeah, yeah. Links down below. Evie Lupine on YouTube. For Pride Month, I am doing more videos about asexuality. I have at least two more videos planned that are going to come out usually like after this one should be coming out. So want to check that out? Go over there. I have a whole asexuality playlist if you want to like get everything all at once and just binge it for like a day. I have that. And yeah, hopefully you guys like this. I'll be watching the comments. If you guys have questions for me or anything else, let me know and we'll follow up.
Okay, perfect. Thank you, Evie. And guys, enjoy, and we'll see you next time. Bye.
All right, thank you. Bye.